you can edit the profile details. You can edit if you want to add your Instagram.
Good afternoon all. As we begin, let's invoke the blessing of God Almighty. Let us bow our heads and place ourselves in the presence of God.
Dear Almighty and ever-loving God, we come into your presence and seek your blessing on everyone present here today. Father, we thank you for keeping us safe and protected during the pandemic. Lord, we specially seek your blessing and divine providence for today's event. We pray that you help us retain the invaluable knowledge and learning experiences we derive from today's event. Lord, we surrender our speakers for the day that they impart their knowledge effectively. Continue to bless them and help them to be at the best throughout the event. Bless the participants as well, so that they would be able to glean the vital information from the webinar. We pray that you continue to bless us all.
Before we begin, just a little reminder, I request all participants to mute yourself for better sound functionality. It's time to learn, save and certify. The Department of CS and IT of College of Engineering and Management, Pulapura, in association with Kent Alumni, presents a webinar series, Jeep Talkathon 1.1, on various topics such as Machine Learning, Introduction to Artificial Intelligence, Intelligence in Computer Vision, Scope of Bioinformatics, etc. I heartily welcome our resource person, Mr. Shailesh S., 2008-12 batch from College of Engineering and Management, Pulapura. Our principal, Dr. Ruben V. Varghese, HODs of all departments, our faculties, participants, and all my dear friends who join with us. It's my pleasure to welcome you all to the webinar conducted by our college. I'm much delighted to offer a healthy and warm welcome to everyone. In the absence of Srimati Smita M. Jasmine, Head of Department of Computer Science and Engineering, I would like to invite Professor Suresh Kumar N., Associate Professor, Department of Computer Science and Engineering, for the presidential address. Sir, please.
Our respected principal, Dr. Ruben K. Varghese, our alumni and resource person of the day, Mr. Shailesh, the alumni coordinator, Professor Vishnupriya, student coordinators, the HODs of all departments, participants, and my dear students. As you already aware about the COVID-19 pandemic that affects each and every corner of our world. As a part of it, our nation is also suffering the problem of the effect of COVID-19 pandemic. The main challenge offered by our nation in this era is unemployment. Higher education play a key role in creating employment among youth in various sectors. The key challenge faced by higher education is to create professionals that can address the requirement of industries. So the Jeep Talkathon 1.1 is an attempt by Department of Computer Science and IT in association with the alumni of CSIT to disseminate disruptive technologies among youth. I thank and wish all the participants to get an overview of the emerging technologies in the technological arena. Before I conclude, I wish to remind you the quote by Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam: every pain gives a lesson, and every lesson changes a person. And I wish the effort put by the participants and coordinators be a game changer in their life. Thank you.
Respected Professor Suresh, the head of the department, Professor Sheena, the coordinator of the function, Alumni Secretary Vishnu Priya MS, resource persons Suresh Ayresh, and all the other six stalwarts of CEMP, faculty, staff of CEMP, and participants of the function. It is very indeed happy moment for us. It's a proud moment for us. We are conducting a series of webinar from very eminent resource persons on a very newest, latest technology front. That way it is open for all over the people all over the world, especially the students of engineering in Kerala. It is indeed a very nice step, especially in the period of COVID, where we are bound to be in home and not able to exercise our routine work or routine way of communicating each other. But whenever there is a crisis comes in, the mankind always try to overcome it, find new ways, find new methods, and even find new lifestyle and adapt itself to survive for the future. And here in CEMP also, it is not much different. We are also trying our level best to bring the technology, latest technology to the students. It is a very proud moment for the alumni of CEMP that eminent resource person from among ourselves is coming back to the college and delivering their latest knowledge to the students. We are dealing with so many topics here, right from artificial intelligence and many other latest technology. Not any college or any university in the world can dream of such topics being dealt in detail in a syllabus, because the technology is changing very fast. At the same time, a problem with the computer science department or computer science students is that we have to be very fast in learning, and we have to be very fast in adapting to the new change. The changes are happening so fast that it is very difficult to be in touch with the latest technology. So in fact, many times by the time we complete the 4-year course, most of the syllabus which we have taken become obsolete. So there is only one way to learn, that is to keep on learning from the forefront of the technology. And here we are getting an opportunity from the good heart of the CEMP alumni. And I would like to thank all the resource person for accepting the invitation of the computer science department to offer their knowledge, a part of their knowledge to the students. And I congratulate the Alumni Association and its coordinators for arranging the program in a systematic way And it is a complete effort, complete coordinated effort from the Department of Computer Science with the coordinator Sheena to make the thing perfectly working. I have seen her and her team working together in hours before or days before the function to check all technical details and to make sure that everybody, every student of Kerala is able to log into the YouTube channel and also have live participation in the Google Meet for getting the maximum benefit of the program. And this is a starting only. I believe that all departments can definitely do similar attempts, because we do have a lot of star-studded alumni all over the world. People are there all over the country, all over the world, doing working at very excellent positions, and they have gained knowledge of at around 10 years. That is a very significant amount. Now, right now, from now onwards, we'll be able to gather the strength of alumni. Every institute comes to the limelight by making use of the connection with the alumni only. Many times people think that the alumni relationship is only for monetary support or for something like that, but it is not like that. Here we need you to guide the youngsters and support them in the form of your sharing your knowledge. And with these words, I wish the program a very great success and declare that the program is inaugurated. Thank you for the opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Let's invite Srimadi Vishnupriya L., Staff Secretary, KEB Alumni Association, for felicitation. Ma'am, please.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone, respected principal and all dignitaries. It gives me an immense pleasure to see everyone gathered here for this wonderful event. I'm really honored to be a part of this. I take this opportunity to congratulate the entire organizing committee from CSIT department for beautifully coordinating this event and ensuring such wide participation in these challenging circumstances. Kudos to all of you guys. Now, I would like to express my sincere and heartfelt gratitude to our dear alumni, without whom this event would never be a reality. On behalf of CEMB Alumni Association, I extend my wholehearted thanks to all esteemed alumni, those who are going to conduct the sessions. Finally, our participants, those who are here to attending the session, I wish you all the very best for your careers and hope these sessions would prove to of immense benefit. Once again, I thank you for inviting me and wish you a grand success. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Just a little housekeeping. If you have any questions during the presentation, please type them into the chat box. We will bring up during the presentation if necessary, or we will also have time to questions at the end. To keep the quality of sound functional during the meeting, please mute yourself. Now, without further ado, we will turn time to resource person, Mr. Shailesh S., our alumni 2008-12 batch from College of Engineering and Management, Punapra. Currently, he is working as Assistant Professor, Department of Computer Science in Circle Head College, Thevara. And only as he got selected for postdoctoral fellowship at Open University, United Kingdom. He has 8+ years of experience in teaching and research and also in the industry as a senior software engineer. His area of research includes artificial intelligence, machine learning, computer vision, video analytics, deep learning, etc. He has participated and presented in several webinars, conferences, workshops, and training programs. He has to accredit several research papers published in reputed journals. Mr. Shailesh S., was awarded Young Scientist Researcher Award 2020, presented by Sacred Heart College, Tevra. He has completed his PhD and submitted the thesis for evaluation at Department of Computer Applications, Cochin University of Science and Technology. He also holds MTech in Computer and Information Science from Cochin University of Science and Technology, BTech in Computer Science and Engineering from College of Engineering and Management, Punapra, and MSc in Mathematics from Madras University. I heartily welcome you, sir. Over to you.
Thank you. Thank you for the warm welcome. Very happy to be here as a resource person for the webinar series. So I hope you are all safe. Am I audible, right? Yeah.
Yes,
okay. Yes. So today we are going to have a talk on unraveling machine learning. Okay. So we can directly go to the topic. So this is the contents we are going to cover. That is, first we are going to break the ice regarding the confusions of data science, machine learning, deep learning, AI. Okay. After that, we will go to the machine learning. What is machine learning? Then what is the difference between programming versus learning? Then what is the usual machine learning pipeline? When to use machine learning, ML applications, as well as the types of learning. Okay. So you are all aware about different the buzzwords like artificial intelligence, machine learning, neural networks, deep learning, data science, big data, all these stuff, right? So before getting into the actual concept of machine learning, you have to definitely differentiate between these things. These are what is actually artificial intelligence, what is machine learning, what is neural network, what is data science, what is big data, and what are the connection between these things. Okay. So generally, you can actually concentrate on a particular domain to excel yourself. Okay. So as you can see in the diagram, this is called as a Venn diagram. As you can see in the diagram, the upper domain is actually artificial intelligence. We all know computer is actually a dumb device. It does not have any intelligence. So artificial intelligence is actually a branch in computer science which makes a system intelligent. Okay, that like just a thing like a human. Okay, so this in artificial intelligence, we have several techniques to make a system more intelligent. So as you can see in the slide, within artificial intelligence, we have machine learning, we have speech, we have computer vision, we have natural language processing, we have expert system, planning and optimization, robotics. All these stuffs are actually covered under artificial intelligence. Okay, so machine learning is one such type of intelligence making. Okay, one such type of intelligence making. As we are doing, we are different ways to make us more intelligent, right? So likewise, in artificial intelligence, machine learning is a kind of intelligent making technique through experience. That is, we have to make a system more intelligent through experience. Okay, so now you are clear that the upper domain is artificial intelligence, and within that, several techniques. And one such technique is called machine learning. Okay, so in machine learning also, within the machine learning area also, we have several algorithms or methodologies to make a machine learn through experience. Okay, so like linear regression, support vector machines, naive Bayes techniques. So these are all based on probabilistics and mathematical theory. Okay, and one such kind of machine learning algorithm is actually called as artificial neural network. It actually depicts the way how our brains work. Okay, and within artificial intelligence, as you can see in the right side, we have different models of artificial neural network, and one such model is actually called as deep neural networks. Okay, and if you are performing machine learning with deep neural network, then it is called as deep learning. Okay, so We have an upper domain, artificial intelligence. Within that, several techniques are there. And one such technique is called machine learning. And within machine learning, there are several algorithms or models exist. And one such model is called neural network. Okay. And a type of neural network is actually called as a deep neural network. And if you are performing machine learning with deep neural network, then we can call it as a deep learning process. Is it clear? I think you got this. And then now comes to the data science pipeline. So what is data science? You may hear about data science, data analytics, data engineering, data mining, all these stuffs, right? So what is actually the difference between these techniques? Okay, data science is actually an end-to-end domain which deals with collecting the data, storing the data, processing the data, modeling the data, deployment, and monitoring the data. Okay, all this comes under data science. Okay, and data analytics and data mining is actually a particular step in this data science pipeline. Okay, as you can see, this is actually here comes the data analytics and data mining kind of techniques. Okay. So, what is the connection between this data science and machine learning, or data science and artificial intelligence? Okay, so in the case of analytics and mining, we have two different ways, that is exploratory analytics, and the other part is descriptive, diagnostic, predictive, and perspective analysis. Okay, so in descriptive analysis, if we have some data, then we are trying to explain why it's happened. Okay. So what is actually happened? Okay, then in diagnostic analysis, we are actually trying to why it happened. So first one is what happened, then we are trying to analyze why it happened. Okay, now in predictive analytics, okay, in predictive analytics, we are trying to forecast the outcome of that, or we are actually trying to predict the future. Okay, and according to that prediction, what all the things we need to take in care is happening in perspective analytics. Okay, so when we are looking into the people who are working in data science, you can see the most of the people are from statistical and mathematical background, and they are using their tools like SPSS, Tableau, Power BI, Excel kind of stuff. But when it comes to predictive and perspective analytics, it is very difficult to do the task with this kind of tools. So we are relying upon some machine learning and artificial intelligence techniques. That is why you can see this intersection between data science and machine learning. Okay. So then finally, when it comes to big data, okay, what do you mean by big data? Okay, is big data equal to large data? Can you say a large data is a big data? It's actually different, because big data is characterized using different properties of data. Okay, different properties of data like volume, velocity, variety, and veracity. Volume, velocity, variety, and veracity. Okay, so if a particular data having a large volume, then we cannot actually process that data within our ordinary computational infrastructure. Okay, so as you can see, in the example, for a single flight across two countries by a flight, okay, it will generate around 20 TB of data, 20 terabytes of data within an hour. Okay, in an hour, it will generate around 20 terabytes of data. So, what is the RAM you have in your computer? It's actually maximum 16 GB, right? So how can we load this 20 GB data into a 16 GB RAM? So our traditional way of computing techniques, as well as the infrastructure, is not enough to analyze those kind of data. Okay, so we have to go behind some different type of infrastructures, algorithms, techniques. So all this comes under big data. Okay, that's the aspect of volume. And the other aspect is velocity, or we can say data in motion. What do you mean by velocity of data? Actually, the velocity of data is actually concerned with the amount of data arriving at a computing environment to process. Okay, suppose you have a campus, right? And within that campus, you have around 100 cameras. Okay, from each camera, there will be around 20 to 30 frames of images comes. So, in a second. So within a second, from 100 cameras, we are getting around 2000 images at the computing environment. So can you just think about how can we process 2000 images in a single second? So the velocity of data is also matter in the case of big data. And the other one is variety of data. Okay, so what is the main source of big data? Okay, as you can see in the left side, there are different ways or the sources for big data. And one of the prominent source of big data is actually Internet of Things. So what do you mean by Internet of Things? Internet of Things is nothing but we can create a network by connecting all our devices in our household or our cars or our mobile phones. Okay, so all these together form a network, and we are calling it as Internet of Things. So what are all the types of data arriving from those devices? From a NACI, there will be some temperature data from the sensors. From cameras, we will have images and videos. Okay, so from audio systems, we will get some audio signals. So we have a variety of data arriving in the computing environment. So our algorithms are not enough. Ordinary algorithms are not enough to analyze these kind of different type of data. And the last one is veracity. Veracity is actually deals with the uncertainty or the reliability of the data. So you can actually make a decision by getting a data from a sensor, right? But can you take a decision by getting a data from the social media? Do you think it is always right? So there will be an uncertainty in data. So these can also be handled with big data. Okay. So in big data also, we are using the machine learning and artificial intelligence techniques for the automated processing, as well as the theoretical aspects from the data science to make it possible to analyze in a good way. Okay. So now I think you are clear with what is actually artificial intelligence, what is actually data science, what is actually big data, and what is machine learning, neural networks, and deep learning. Okay, so you must be able to differentiate between these technologies and just make an understanding regarding these techniques and try to find out your area. Okay, so you are more convenient with mathematical and statistical stuff. You can actually go behind the data science, and if you are more with the computing part or the programming and algorithmic part, you can actually go for artificial intelligence and machine learning area. And if you wish to work with the large infrastructures, both in computational way and mathematical way, you can actually go behind this big data stuffs. Okay, hope you are clear with these stuffs. Now we can move to our major topic, which is called machine learning. Okay. A learning is any process by which a system improves performance from experience. Okay, so learning is any process by which a system improves performance from experience. That system can be a computer system, a human, whatever it is. If a system improves its performance through experience, we can call it as a learning process. Okay, and when it comes to machine learning, it is a definition by Tom Mitchell. He's a great scientist, computer scientist, wrote so many books in AI and machine learning. Okay, machine learning stuff. So by his definition, machine learning is the study of algorithms that improve their performance P at some task T with experience E. That is, we have to perform some task T. Okay, so for that, we have to improve our performance. That is P. And with what we have to improve? With the experience, we have to improve the performance. So we can consider machine learning as a tuple, PTE, where P is the performance, T is the task, and E is the experience. So as you as everyone like, we are not really more into mathematical definition of these stuff. So I will explain with the help of a simple example. Okay, so you are all familiar with the film PK, right? So who is that PK? Amir Khan movie, right? Who is that PK? He's actually from an alien from the other planet. Okay, so he is not about anything in Earth. So consider you are a companion of PK. Okay, you are a companion of PK, and you are trying to make PK learn PK about the things in our Earth. Okay. The PK should identify an objective shirt top. Okay. If you're showing a shirt and asking PK whether it is a shirt or not, he should reply yes or no. Okay. So this PK on the right side, PK, and on the left side, you. Okay. So what you are going to do is you are showing a green color formal large shirt and to PK and telling that PK, this is a shirt we are used to wear. Okay. So the PK will have a perception like, okay, for a shirt, the color should be green, the size should be large, and the type should be formal. Okay. So after that, we are showing another shirt, which is a small shirt of a red color, and we are asking that, is that a shirt? So PK will match that shirt with his perception. So the color should be green, but in the example it is red. So definitely PK will tell this is not a shirt, because in his perception the color of the shirt must be green, but in the example it is red. Okay, so what we are doing is you are again telling that this is also a shirt. So the perception of the PK will change. The color can be either green or red. The size can be large or small, and the type can be formal or casual. Okay. Again, I'm showing another shirt, which is also a large shirt, but the color is yellow. Again, PK will say it is not a shirt, because the color is not either green or red. The size is actually large, and it is a casual type. But the first thing, that is, the color is not matching with PK's perception, and PK will say no. Again, I'm telling that this is also a shirt. So again, the perception of PK is changing. And after giving as much examples to the PK is now able to identify every shirt. Okay, so this is actually what happening in machine learning. Okay, so here, what is the task? T, identifying whether the object is shirt or not. Okay, what is the performance? Accuracy in predicting whether it is shirt or not. And what is the experience? We have all the examples given to the PK. Okay, so now I think you are okay with what is actually machine learning. Okay, machine learning is actually the improvement of the performance of an algorithm to perform a particular task through experience. So we can simply say learn from experience. Okay, so if you have any doubts, you can ask the learning part. Okay. So what is the difference between programming and learning? What is the actual difference between programming and machine learning? Is there any problem with the broadcasting? Please. Hello. Andrish Shonovis. Hello. Okay. Hello. Am I audible?
Audible.
Sir, you are audible.
Yes, sir.
Sir, you are audible.
Fine.
So now, what is the actual difference between programming and learning? Okay. Programming and learning.
In traditional programming, you actually know the data as well as the algorithm.
Okay. Algorithm is the logic to convert the data to output.
Okay.
Like suppose you are given with the three sides of a triangle. Okay. So you can find out the area by applying the equation root of S into S minus A into S minus B into S minus A, right? So in traditional, you know the data, the input, as well as logic to transform that input to output. Okay. But in the case of machine learning, you are actually having the data as well as the output, but you don't know how to convert this data to output. Okay. Like in the case of you have the past 50 years of results of the football match, and can you actually predict who will be the winner in the next match? Okay. Somehow we can predict that using some statistical stuff, but you don't know actually the logic how to actually predict the result of a football match in the future.
Okay.
So in that case, we have the data as well as the output. So through machine learning, we are actually trying to find out the logic behind the transformation of data or the input to output. So we are trying to find out the connection between this data and output, and we can actually call it as a we are actually transforming logic as a machine learning pipeline.
So in a machine learning pipeline there are several steps. First we have to process that data to make it compatible for machine learning, and after preparing the data
you can apply that data to a machine learning algorithm, and we can train that machine learning algorithm to learn certain things. Okay. After training, the algorithm will be converted to a model, and this model is now capable of predicting or forecasting something. And this model can be applied
in
any applications. So this is the usual pipeline of a machine learning task.
Sir, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you. Sir, can you please pause for a moment? There is some issue with the audio. Okay.
I will reach you when the problem is solved.
Is it okay?
Sir, you may please turn now.
Yeah, okay. Now we can go to the application of machine learning. We can apply machine learning everywhere. Please wait, I will just unmute. Hello.
Yes, sir, it's okay now.
Yeah.
Okay. So after
so
after
as I said learning after learning we can apply machine learning we can apply machine learning everywhere. Okay.
We have to find out some scenarios that we can
actually apply machine learning.
Because for the case of supermarket software or repair of software, we need not to go behind machine learning, right?
So we have to clearly identify where actually we can apply machine learning. Okay. Some of the scenarios are actually shown in this slide. First one is human expertise does not exist. Human expertise does not exist means, suppose we are trying to deploy some robots in Mars. Okay. So we have to analyze something on that planet, and we have to perform the analysis process in a human-like fashion. So we have to make that robotic system in a more intelligent, or it should be able to perform the task in a human-like fashion. So in that part, for intelligence making in that particular robot, we can use machine learning. Okay. And in the case of human can't explain their expertise. Human can't explain their expertise. Okay. So consider the situation that you are all having landphones in your home, right? And after getting call from a particular person several times, on getting that call the next time, you will be able to identify that person at the other end, right? So how this process is actually happening in your brain? Can you explain that? Are you able to explain that process, what is actually happening in your brain? How will you recognize the person at the other end? For that, in that case, we are doing that recognition or identification process somehow, but we cannot actually explain that process, right? So in that case also, we can use machine learning, okay? And the customized models, like suppose you are actually creating a software for predicting personalized medicines for different patients, okay? So a set of symptoms for one patient may not be same for the other person, okay? They might have two different diseases, but they have the same symptoms. So in that case, the system must be able to clearly identify the person as well as the symptoms and diagnose or the actually recommend the medicines, okay? So in that case, we are actually applying different types of machine learning techniques in a customized fashion. And definitely in the case of huge amount of data, okay, in the case of huge amount of data also, we have to apply some machine learning techniques, and it is highly related to the big data techniques, because we cannot analyze big data or the large data in a traditional way, okay? So how actually this huge data is arriving, or what is the need of analyzing it? You know about the DNA structure, right? It is encoded with the four characters ATGC. And when you decode a particular DNA of an organism, it will be like around 3 or 4 GBs, okay? And the human and the monkey have around 99% similar DNA. So with that 1% only, we are having this difference from monkeys. Okay. So it will be very difficult to analyze where is the change. Okay. So two DNAs itself will take around 10 GBs. So how will you compute, how will you analyze those type of data? Okay. In that case also, we can apply machine learning. Okay. Now we are moving to what are the different types of machine learning techniques exist? Okay. What are the different types of machine learning techniques exist? Okay. In the case of machine learning, we can see there are three different types of learnings. The first one is supervised learning. The other one is unsupervised learning. And the last one is reinforcement learning. Okay. Supervised learning, unsupervised learning, and reinforcement learning. Okay. So in the case of supervised learning, we have several tasks like fraud detection, image classifications, forecasting,
process optimization. And in the case of unsupervised learning, we have other several techniques like feature selections, segmentations, clustering, anomaly detection. And also the reinforcement learning has several applications in game development, robotics, skill acquisition kind of things. And we are going to discuss each of this type of learning, like supervised learning, unsupervised learning, and reinforcement learning in detail. So what is actually supervised learning? In the case of supervised learning, as I said, we have the data as well as the output. Okay. We have the data as well as the output. This data is actually presented in the form of x1, x2, etc. up to xn. And the output is actually like y. Okay. So what is this actually? These x1, x2, etc. up to x1 are the features, okay? The features of an input we are trying to analyze. Like suppose if you are trying to create a machine learning technique to predict whether a student will pass or fail the exam. So what are the features we need to take in care? We have to take the time he is spending for the studies, what is the previous marks he got, and what is his interest. All these things are the features that describe the student entity. And these features are actually represented using this x1, x2, etc. up to xn. Okay. And we have several such data. We have the records of past record of several students. And we have the details whether those students is actually passed or not. Okay. So we have a label data. We have the input as well as the output. And in the case of supervised learning, what we are trying to create is we are trying to create a predictor that maps from X to Y. That is, we are trying to find out the connection between these inputs and the output. Okay. And after creating that predictor, F, you can use that predictor to predict the one of the future input and you will get the prediction. Okay, this is actually depicted in this example. We have apples here, we have cupcakes here. Here we are creating a machine learning model for deciding whether the given object is apple or cupcake. After creating that model, you can give a new input and the model is now able to predict whether it is a cupcake or apple. So here we have the labels. These instances 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 are labeled as apples, and these 5 instances are labeled as cupcakes. Okay. So now on giving a new input to the machine learning model, it is now able to predict whether it is a cupcake or apple. Okay. This is actually what happening in supervised learning. We have a label data. We are trying to create a machine learning model to find out the connection between the data as well as the output, or the input as well as the output. Okay. And when we look into the major supervised learning techniques, we can see there are two different tasks, like classification and regression. Okay. Classification and regression. In the case of classification, on giving a particular input, we are trying to map that input to some of the classes. So those classes will be discrete. Okay, whether we are having a particular disease or not, whether the given email is spam or not. Okay, so whether given the for a given object, whether it is a bat, ball, or a cork. Okay, so these kind of classifications are, or the mapping to a particular class is actually happening in classification. Okay, so we have features and discrete labels, maps and input to a discrete label, and we are trying to predict on getting a particular image, we are trying to predict whether the level of cancer. Okay, so we are trying to map that input to a particular discrete class. But in the case of regression, we have the feature as well as the output, but the output values are now real values. Okay, so we are trying to predict the real values for a given input. Okay, so it will be clear with this example. Suppose with the weather conditions, you are trying to predict the
temperature of the next day or tomorrow's temperature, then it can be any value, right? Any real value. This is called as a regression. And if you are trying to predict whether the hot or cold, whether the weather is cloudy or sunny, then it will be a classification problem. So now we have only two discrete classes, but here we have a range of real values to predict. Okay, this is actually what happening in regression and what happening in classification. Okay, and in the case of unsupervised learning, as you can see here, we have in the supervised learning, we have the features as well as the output. Okay, but in the case of unsupervised learning, we don't have that labels or the outputs associated with each input. Okay, so it is called as an unlabeled data. Then what actually we are trying to analyze, okay, what we are actually trying to analyze, we cannot map any input to output because we don't have any output here. So what is the actual thing happening in unsupervised learning? In unsupervised learning, we are actually trying to find out the hidden relationship between the inputs. Is there any relationship between these inputs? That is actually what we are trying to analyze in unsupervised learning. The outlier detections. Okay, outlier detection. You might have an experience like you have several friends in your class, but someone will stand alone from that group. Okay, he's called as an outlier. Okay, so those kind of outlier detection, or as in the second example, we have several birds and fishes here. Okay, so with their property, we have to group them into a set of fishes and set of birds, which is called as clustering process. So okay, so these things are actually happening in unsupervised learning. Okay, so two major applications of unsupervised learning is, first one is clustering. Okay, clustering is actually grouping of several elements into several groups according to their similarity. According to the similarity of the object, we have to group them into several groups. Okay, this is what we are calling as clustering. And there is another technique called association rule mining. What is actually association rule mining? You might have an experience like after buying a mobile phone, and at the payment page you will get some recommendations like the person who bought this phone might buy a charger or a tempered glass. Okay, and you would wish to buy that also. Okay, those kind of recommendations you will get, right? So what is actually happening there? How it actually happened? Because from the purchase history of a person, they can actually find some commodities or some items are purchased together. Okay, purchased together, and on buying a particular item, there's a chance for buying another item. Okay, you might have heard about a particular example like in after analyzing the purchase history of a famous supermarket, a market chain, someone found that there's a chance of buying diapers. Okay, there's a chance for dyeing diapers if someone buy a beer bottle. Okay, do you think that is strange? What is the connection between this diapers and beer bottles? When the people go behind the connection for this diaper and beer, and they found that in foreign countries, the Saturday nights they have parties. Okay, so at that party they have beer, and on that time they have to make their babies in a babysit. Okay, so for that purpose they need to buy diapers also. So there's a strange connection between the purchase of diapers and beers. Okay, in a usual way we cannot actually find this connection. Okay, so by applying machine learning techniques like association rule mining or the item set mining, we can say that there will be a connection between diaper and beer. Okay, so the items togetherly purchased is called the frequent item set, and there will be a connection on buying a diaper. There's a chance to buy a beer bottle. Okay, this is called as association rules, and these are all these things comes under unsupervised learning. Okay, so the last type is actually reinforcement learning. Reinforcement learning is actually a token based learning, or we can say a reward based learning. Okay, what is actually this token based learning? Because it's like a training a dog. Okay, we will let a dog to perform a particular task or do a particular task, and on if he's doing in a proper way, we will give a biscuit. Otherwise, we will give a slap. Okay. So if a particular algorithm is performing a task in a proper way, then we will give a good reward to that algorithm. Otherwise, we will give a bad reward. Okay. On getting the good rewards, the algorithm will try to repeat the same task in a good way. Okay. And on getting a bad reward, it will try to eliminate that particular path of execution in the next trials. Okay, so in this way, after several iterations, the algorithm is now able to perform that particular task in a proper way. These kind of learnings are called reinforcement learning. Mostly we are implementing this with software agents and the reward based things. Okay, so these kind of techniques are usually used in robotics, game theory kind of stuff. Okay, and apart from all these techniques, there is another technique called semi-supervised learning. Okay, semi-supervised learning, which is actually a hybrid version of supervised learning and unsupervised learning. Okay, in the case of supervised learning, we have a labeled data, but in the case of unsupervised learning, we have unlabeled data, right? So in a usual scenario, it is very difficult to get the unlabeled, the labeled data. Okay, most of the data will be actually unlabeled. Okay, so with that few labeled data, we will try to create a machine learning model to label the rest of the unlabeled data, and after labeling it, we will try to create a new machine learning model. So we are combining here the supervised learning techniques and unsupervised learning technique. Okay, so now you know what are the different type of learning techniques. Okay, and what is actually the connection between the data and machine learning, data science and machine learning? Okay, they are actually complementing each other. Okay, as in the slide, if you can see, if machine learning is a rocket engine, then data is actually its fuel. Okay, data is actual fuel. Okay, so they are actually complementing to each other, and there is a very very high demand for this data. So some years back, the overall economy, overall the world economy is controlled by the petroleum products. Now actually the commodity that can that to be controlled the entire economy will be data. Okay, so it is very important to do some data kind of data analysis kind of things to for the near future, that the near 10 years of future will be actually the era of AI, machine learning and data science. Okay, so I will show you some real implementations of these techniques. Okay, so then you will get an idea what is actually supervised, what is actually unsupervised, and what is actually reinforcement learning. Okay, so this is an example of supervised learning. Okay, so you can see a simple example of supervised learning. Here, on getting a face, we are actually trying to predict whether the person is wearing a mask or not. So we are actually mapping a face to mask or not mask face. Okay, so what is the technique we are applying here. It is actually a classification, okay, and it is a supervised learning technique, okay. And in the second example, you can see so in this example, what you can see is we are actually grouping the objects according to their similarity. Okay, we are actually grouping the object according to the similarity. So what is the process behind this? This is called as clustering, and this is a unsupervised learning technique. Okay, and finally, okay, so in this example, actually we have implemented the reinforcement learning here. We are playing, and the computer system itself is a opponent, and that opponent system is actually created using reinforcement learning. Okay, so these are the different types of learning techniques we have in machine learning. Okay, so hope you understand the concepts well. Now we can go for a question answering system process. Okay,
thank you, sir, for giving your valuable insights on the topic. We are moving on to the Q&A section, and if you have any doubts, you may please ask in the chat box. Thank you.
If you have any doubts, you can ask regarding this. Any doubts?
No, sir.
Yes.
So, organizing committee, I think if there is no doubts, we can actually wind up.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Yeah.
So, with this, we wind up the session. And I hope that today's discussion were enriching and worth all of the time. Gratitude is the fairest blossom which springs from the soul. On behalf of the organizing committee and the institution, I sincerely thank our resource person, Mr. Shailesh Shivan, for finding time out of your heavy schedule and making this ours with your glorious presence. It's time to express our heartfelt gratitude to our dear principal, Dr. Rubin V. Varghese, for keeping his faith on us and giving us this opportunity to organize the webinar series. Thank you, sir, for rendering your constant support throughout. A big thank you for HODs of all departments and faculties of our college. On behalf of the institution, I would now like to thank and congratulate the webinar coordinators, Mr. Suresh Kumar N. and Ms. Sheena N. for their meticulous coordination. As we come to the end of the event, I would like to acknowledge and appreciate the organizing committee members for contributing their best and working towards the completion of the first day. We thank all the student committee members for being commendably cooperative and for providing the creative inputs. We indeed have a long way to go. Thank you very much for all the patience and support. Please do provide your feedback to us on the link and the chat room. We will be happy to hear from you. Looking forward to see you all in the coming days. Thank you. And I hope you enjoy the rest of your day. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Shailesh.
Okay, sir, thank you.